like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear. The Keens up around here, yes. I remember growing up, I grew up in Smithfield, and my grandparents lived in Benson, and they actually attended Unity at a Christian church, and so we knew Pastor Billy and Judy and their family, and just how it all intertwined. The more I've grown up and realized, oh my goodness, they're related to Ann and Alan, and I've known them for years, and Bobby Keene over at Keene's Convenient back in the day, and Miss Keene, and it's just amazing how it all meshed together, and that's how the body of Christ is. It all just comes together, and today you've come together to honor this man of God. I'm going to read part of his obituary to you, not that you haven't read it, but I think it's something to be said. Mr. Keene was born in Johnson County, a good old Joco man. Even when he moved to the big city of Garner, They tried to call it Raleigh, but it was Garner. He was still a joke of a man. He was born February 3rd, 1944, to the late Theron and Mildred Lassiter Keene. He was preceded in death by his wife, Elizabeth K. Keene, sisters Ann Hargis, Shirley Parker, and brothers Edward Keene, Bobby Keene, and Charles Keene. Mr. Keene is retired from the Public Utilities Department with the City of Raleigh. He was a member of Garner Advent Christian Church in Garner, North Carolina. He loved spending time with his family and woodworking. Mr. Keene served in the U.S. Army National Guard from 1962 until 1970. Survivors include his son Tim and wife Stephanie of Kinley, North Carolina, grandchildren Jordan Keene and wife Cherokee, and Logan Keene and grandson Kate Self, stepson Hunter Weaver, brother Reverend Billy Keene, and many nieces and nephews. Large family, large family. Let's pray together and ask God's presence to manifest itself in this room today. God, such an honor to be in your presence, even in a place where we celebrate life that is no more here on earth, God. God, I pray today that as we celebrate Max Keene and the legacy that he leaves behind through his family, I pray that you'd be honored through the words that are said, the words that are sung. God, I pray that you would just move by your Holy Spirit in our midst, Lord, and help us to realize that that you are here, God. When we leave this place, help us to know we've been in your presence, and help us to recognize that we've seen a moving of your Spirit even in our midst, God. Lord, I pray for this family today. I pray that you would help them, even in this time, to reflect on the goodness of your mercy, God, and how merciful you have been to Max over these 79 years, Lord. Be honored in our midst here today, God, in your name we pray. Amen. Oh, when Tim called me about, he said, I need your help with that service. And I said, I'll do anything you need me to do. Thinking the whole time it was singing or playing, because I can sing or play all day long. Amen. And then he said, I'd like for you to speak. And I'm like, what? Wait a minute. So here we are. Y'all are stuck with me today. When I think of Max, I think of a long life. I'm getting to be an old man myself, and I remember as a young fella back at Unity with my grandparents, all Max and his siblings, all Pastor Billy's siblings were always around. They were always hanging around with me. I would go to the mountains with the church group, and there they would all be. Then later in life, I went off to Bible college and came back and started working for the Lord. And I'm in my 32nd or 33rd year of ministry, and I haven't preached a whole lot. I've preached one or two sermons here or there, but I've sung some songs in my day, and ended up working at Garner Advent Christian Church. And lo and behold, there was Max. And I was there for 8 or so years. Max and Elizabeth, they were a backbone. That church and find Christian people. And so what I gained from my time in Garner from Max and Elizabeth was I saw firsthand the love that they had for me and my family. Me and my 4 kids, we had 3 biological kids and we had adopted a kid, and they showed such grace and love for my family. And so I want to talk about some of the love that I have sensed come from Max's life. He certainly had a love for family. He loved being a dad. He loved being a papa. And then my understanding is he absolutely adored and loved being a poopa to Kate. That's a pretty cool name. I have 2 grandchildren that call me doodad. So I get the whole poopa thing. You know? Everybody in the family was important to Max. He certainly had a love for Elizabeth. Funny story about Elizabeth and Max and me. In all my time of knowing Max and Elizabeth, I never knew any different than what I'm about to tell you. I ran into Tim and Stephanie. They're already laughing because they know what I'm going to tell. I ran into them at the ball field in Selma. Tim was pitching for a church league team, and there sat Stephanie over. So I go over to talk to Stephanie. And it was about the time that Max was maybe having little issues with memory, and I knew Elizabeth had been a little sick. And so I was having a conversation, innocent conversation with Stephanie, and said, so how's Tim's mama doing? And she said, she's good. And I said, well, I know she's got a lot on her caring for Mr. Max. And Tim's mother was sitting beside Stephanie and spoke up, Mrs. Cullen, and said, I am Tim's mom. And my foot was in my mouth innocently, and I said to them, I am so sorry. I said, in all my years of knowing Max and Elizabeth, never once did Elizabeth say, this is my stepson. Never. She said, this is our son. Yep. And so that's speaks well of Elizabeth, and it speaks well of Carolyn that she didn't get up and whoop me right there. But that was a funny situation for me. But anyway, he certainly had a love for Elizabeth. They were married for 43 years, is that my understanding? You could see that love when they looked after one another. They looked after. I had the blessing earlier this year selling their home in Garner for the family, and you could sense the love in that home, lots of love in that home. He certainly had a love for Tim and Stephanie and how blessed he was these last little bit of his life to have you guys. Not everybody has that. He's blessed. I'm hoping out of my 4 kids, one of them will take care of me one day. He certainly had a love for Jordan and Cherokee and Logan and absolutely adored Cade. Funny story about Cade that I heard just last night. Sometimes Mr. Max would be dozing off in his electric lip chair, and Cade would want to talk to him. And I would try to wake him up, and Poopaw, hey Poopaw! And Poopaw wouldn't, may not wake up. And so Cade knew how to remedy that. He knew where the control was for that lift chair. And Tim said sometimes he'd glance over there and Mr. Max would say, whoa, hey now. And he was standing him up while he was asleep. Cade had that figured out. I think that's pretty funny. And he certainly had a love for his siblings. Never heard Max talk bad about any of his family. He loved his brothers and his sisters. And those siblings were very good to my grandparents. My grandmother was a widow for 25 plus years, and they were so kind and generous to her. And he just had a love for people. He loved people. He loved his friends. Talk about friends. I remember his buddies, Joe and Lois. I see them over here. Tight buddies. Charles and Shelby. He's tight friends with you all. And Devon and Francis. And I see Devon back there. He loved all his friends, his family of faith at the Garner Church. He loved that Sunday school class. Boy, y'all was tight. Y'all were tight. And he loved you all some kind of something. He showed love for me while I was there and for Joe Pritchett while he was there. I think he kind of left about the same time I did. But he showed some love for the people of that church. He was so kind and gracious. My understanding is he had a love for chocolate chip cookies and ice cream. What kind of ice cream? Strawberry. Strawberry. Got to have some strawberry ice cream. And it had to be a particular, Logan was saying last night, it's a particular kind of chocolate chip cookie. Which was it? Chips Ahoy?
Chips
Ahoy, yes. He had a love for the Word of God. Something to be said for that. His favorite verse dated back to his mother's birth year. Psalm 19:14, which says, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. It's a great verse. We all would get along a whole lot better if we all lived by that verse. He loved his profession. I understand that he loved working for the city of Raleigh, taking care of their water. All those people in Raleigh owe him something. You got bad water, you got a bad situation. And he made sure they had good water. He loved his profession. He loved the United States of America. He served his country and through the Army National Guard. That's something to be said. He loved America. He loved woodworking. I tried to look on some lapels to see if I saw any little wooden crosses, and I have not seen any in here today, but I guarantee you I got my story right at my house. Matter of fact, I ran across this little fish that I'm positive that he made and gave to me a few years ago. I believe that he was wearing one of those wooden crosses at Elizabeth's funeral a couple of years ago, or a year ago. But he loved wood. He loved taking something that God had created through a tree and making it into something else. I made the mistake of taking this little keychain part off of this earlier today, trying to figure out how he made this. I like never got it back together, but he was very talented. In that home that we talked about selling earlier this year, he had a wood shop out there. He was phenomenal with a piece of wood. I got a pen that he created. He was just gifted with wood, and he loved that. And he loved God. He loved attending anything that revolved around the Word of God. And there's something to be said for that. I want to read to us today. I know Max lived a full life, and we would love for him to have been around many more years, but God had a different plan. But I want to read to us from 2 Samuel today. I'm going to read from verse 12, chapter 12, verse 15. Then Nathan went home, and the Lord caused the son of David, Bathsheba, Uriah's widow, to be very sick. David prayed to God for that baby. David fasted and went into his house, and he stayed there, lying on the ground all night. The elders of David's family came to him and tried to pull him up from the ground, but he refused to get up or to eat with them. On the seventh day, the baby died. David's servants were afraid to tell David that the baby was dead. They said, "Look, we tried to talk to David while the baby was alive, but he refused to listen to us. If we tell him the baby is dead, he may do something awful." And when David saw the servants whispering, he knew that the baby was dead. So he asked them, "Is the baby dead?" And they answered, "Yes, he has passed." Then David got up from the floor. He washed himself. He put lotions on and he changed clothes. Then he went into the Lord's house to worship. After that, he went home and asked his servants to fix him something to eat. And they gave him some food and he ate. David's servants were confused and they said to him, "Why did you do this when the baby was still alive? You fasted and you cried. And now the baby is dead. And you get up and you get food and you eat." And David said, "While the baby was still alive, I fasted and cried, and I thought, who knows, maybe the Lord will feel sorry for me and let the baby live. But now that the baby is dead, why should I fast for him to be healed? I can't bring him back to life, but I can go to where he is one day." And I think there's something to be said for that. As much as it hurts to lose a loved one, and all of us in here have lost one, or you're going too soon, I'm just telling you, it's a fact of life. Regardless of what you believe about life after death, I believe that the next thing that Max will see, we all will see when we close our eyes, will be Jesus' face. And the only way we can see Max again and spend time again with Max is if we make sure that we get where he's going, and that was to heaven. I'm not the smartest man in the world, but I would believe that even in this room, when I look around and I see folks that I believe are believers, that maybe some aren't walking in the right walk with God. And maybe we need to do a self-check and make sure that we can get to where he's going. So that one day when we get to heaven, that's where Max will be. Funny that David, he could have laid on that floor and just died fasting. But instead, he washed off himself, got his best clothes on, got his Sunday go-to-meeting church clothes on, and he went and worshiped the Lord. And I'm telling you in this place today that what Max Keene would want you to do is he would want you to worship the Lord. And he would want you to say, "Thank you, Lord, for the life of Max Keene." I'd like for us to take the back of that bulletin that you received. It just so happens that some notes that I had created, I was going to read this passage. And then when Tim gave me a copy of this last night on the way home, I was like, "Oh my goodness, it's got it on the back. We're going to read it together." Psalm 23. Would you read with me? I'm from Johnston County. I promise I'll read slowly. Okay? "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the peace that passes all understanding, God, and we know that that can only come from you. God, I know that you've been faithful to Max for all these years, God. You've supplied his needs. He would tell you probably that he lived better than he deserved. And it's because of you and your mercy. God, we're thankful today for Tim and Stephanie who opened their home to to Max and had him live in their home with them, God. I pray blessings over them in the days to come as they mourn the passing of Max and they miss him. God, I pray that you would help them to be reminded to continually worship you. Help them to lift their hands and worship you. Help them to lift their eyes to you, God. God, I pray that you would bring peace to even Cade and these grandchildren today, God. Help them to have an understanding that Max is in your presence, Lord. God, I pray that you would give us all a peace of mind that's where we're going to be one day, God. And if there's one in this room that don't know you, Jesus, I pray that you would draw them unto you even right now, God. Help them to find one of the pastors in the room, God. And let's get that straight so that they know that when their time comes to leave this earth, they know where they're going. God, I pray that you would help these folks that have assembled here to travel safely as we travel to the cemetery in a few moments, God, and as we go separate ways. And help us to when we think of Max in the days to come, to maybe whisper a prayer for the Keene family as they continue to mourn. God, thank you for your sweet presence in this room today. Thank you for this funeral home that has served this community. God, I pray blessings over them even today, God. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Y'all been dying to do this. Let's sing.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Amen. Let's pray. God, thank you for being the great God that you are. Thank you that you knew on this very day that we'd be in this place. God, I pray that you would go before us, prepare a way for us to be a true witness for you and to draw others to you, God. Help us to be like Max, never a stumbling block, God, but always a stepping stone for someone to get closer to you. Be honored as we leave this place, God, as we travel to the graveside. In your name we pray. Amen. Everyone would stand except for the family.